So first of all, I'd like to introduce my colleague, Dr. Sylvie Cloutier, who is a research assistant professor in the Department of Integrated Physiology and Neuroscience, and also a fellow in the Center for the Study of Animal Well-Being here at WSU. Dr. Cloutier's research focuses on assessing animal well-being and improving care and husbandry of animals in research. And she's also interested in assessing and improving the quality of human-animal interactions. Dr. Cloutier is currently teaching a course on issues related to human-animal bond and interaction. She's also representing the International Society for Applied Ethology on the Board of Trustees of the Association for the Assessment and Accreditation of Laboratory Animal Care. That's a mouthful. And she's also a member of Washington State University's IACUC, Institutional Animal Care and Use Committee here at WSU. So she'll be speaking first, and she'll be followed by our out-of-town guest. Dr. Gary Varner is a professor and the head of the Department of Philosophy at Texas A&M University. He wrote one of the first dissertations on environmental ethics and has since published two books and over 50 shorter pieces on related topics, including hunting, animal agriculture, and human nutrition, medical research, cloning, and pet ownership. Dr. Varner's current work focuses on applying the two-level or Kantian utilitarianism of R.M. Hare to questions about the moral and legal status of animals. So he has recently published a book, Personhood, Ethics, and Animal Cognition, Situating Animals in Hare's Two-Level Utilitarianism, which was published in 2012 with Oxford University Press. And that's only part one of a two-part series. And so the second book, which is forthcoming, and obviously you should buy both of them to get the full picture, is going to be called Sustaining Animals, Envisioning Humane, Sustainable Communities. And that'll be forthcoming. Dr. Varner says, don't hold your breath, it'll be a few years, because he's also got plenty of work as the department head down at Texas A&M. And then our final speaker will be Dr. Stephen Russell, who's the director of the Office of the Campus Veterinarian here at Washington State University. In short, he is the campus vet, right? He received his doctorate in veterinary medicine here in 1996 after completing his residency in laboratory animal medicine at the University of Missouri. Dr. Russell served as a veterinarian at the University of Louisville before returning here to WSU. He's current director of the Office of the Campus Veterinarian, and in that capacity, he's responsible for assuring that all animals used in research, testing, and teaching are used properly and that they receive adequate veterinary care. So the idea is that we've got someone to share with us about the science of animal cognition to give us a background, and then we've got someone who will present on the ethics, the philosophy of using animals in experimentation, and then we've got the campus vet who can speak to all the different ways that animals are being used on campus. So I think we've got a valuable set of panelists for you, and will give us a variety of different perspectives on the ethics of using animals in research. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Cloutier, who will present first.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the symposium. This is exciting to talk about animal cognition and emotion. And I just want first to mention that a lot of the work that I will present is has been done by or pioneered by my colleague Yak Pengsep, who is also a faculty here at WSU. So you will hear this name a lot if you don't know him already. So let's talk about cognition and emotion. But before talking about cognition, we need to know, like, what is the foundation behind cognition. And what that is affects or feelings. Because feelings arise from this ancient neural network that we have that is situated in our midbrain region, so in the lower part of our brain. And this is the foundation of emotion. Go down. Okay, so where is that located in the brain? So if you look at this brain here, so the midbrain, which is also called the limbic system, is where we have all these basic primal emotion, or that we also call affect. So it's this area of the brain here. And this is surrounded by the cortex, which generates complex cognitive abilities and perception, learning, and culture, and that's where cognition is happening. So, and what we learn from research is that this part, this middle part, the limbic system, we are sharing this part of the brain with other mammals. So it's a very ancient part. The cortex is more recent, and depending on the species, it varies in complexity. So which suggests that cognition will vary based on, you know, the cortex. So why do we have emotion? What is the function of emotion? Well, emotion is part of the neurobiological mechanisms that have evolved to help an individual differentiate between types of stimuli, so hostile or hospitable stimuli, and to organize and adaptive responses to these stimuli. So, and that enables the animals to evaluate the stimuli and then respond to them in using like specific patterns that are most adaptive and well, to the species and to the environment or the situation where this is happening. Here we go. So according to Panksepp, there's in the brain, there's three emotional level or processes, and that can be divided as you see on the slide. So there's a primary process or basic level of affects, which includes emotional affects. So these are basic emotion. And at this level, we also have what we call homeostatic affects, such as hunger and thirst, and also sensory affects, like pain or pleasure. So above that basic level, then we have what we call the secondary process emotion. And that's where all the learning is happening. So classical conditioning, which is a very basic form of learning, as well as more complex type of learning like operant conditioning. This is where this is happening in the brain. And above all that, in the cortex, we have the tertiary affect level, and that's where we have all the cognitive functions occurring. Okay, so if we look at primary process, as I said, human and animals, mammals, share basic emotion. So what you see here is a sad baby and scared women. Well, if we look at animals, we can see that they have these basic emotions and they express them in similar ways as humans. So if we look into a little bit more details at these primary emotional systems. So there are seven systems that have been identified currently. And you can see them on this slide. So we have, and these systems are here, and they have been associated with specific brain areas and also with neuromodulators. So these seven systems are called seeking system, the rage system, which is associated with anger, the fear system, which is associated with fear and anxiety, lust, which is associated with sexuality. There's a care system, which is about nurturance, the panic, which is the separation or grief system, and then finally the play system. Okay, and if you want more information about these systems to learn more about what they're doing, they are detailed in Yock's book, Affective Neuroscience. So an example of that we share these systems, these basic systems with animals, is the following. So you can see in 2000, Damasio and colleagues published the results of their work where they identified the human sadness system that you see here. And you can see that this system is very similar to what Panksepp and his colleagues had identified in the guinea pig, which is what they called at the time the separation distress circuit. So it's, you know, going through the same areas of the midbrain. So if we look at the other emotional levels, so, and this is, if we look at what's happening in human with these emotional system, at the early in development, so in little kids, the primary process system is very important. The secondary and tertiary processes are not as important. But as we get older, so things are changing, and the tertiary and secondary process are becoming more important, more than the primary process. Okay, and typically we're listening more to, you know, if we can say to our brain, then letting our emotion, you know, take over. So, and that's one of the things that what's happening at the tertiary process, it's controlling, it's, you know, regulating what are our emotions. So in animals, we can see that this, you know, a same leveling, but depending on the development of their cortex, we might not see this as well developed as in humans, this at the tertiary level process. Nope, we have to go the other way. So another way of presenting these three levels of emotion is in this arts picture. So you can see the basic emotional level, the secondary level where we have more learning occurring, and then at the tertiary level we have more complex behavior occurring, or not behavior, but emotions happening at that level. Okay, so how is emotion measured? So emotion at the basic level cannot be quantified directly, and that's why for so many years, you know, we were not talking about emotion, you know, as in science, but they can still be assessed indirectly through behavior and through vocalizations, for example. And a lot of the work from Dr. Panksepp has shown that vocalizations can predict or are associated with areas of the brain that have been associated with positive or negative affect. And of course, physiology. Physiology will change as, you know, with affect or with our response to the environment. So how is our animal's cognitive abilities measured? Similarly, they're inferred from behavior. And at this point, we may never be scientifically, it may never be scientifically possible to know whether animals have emotion at higher levels, especially at the tertiary level, because that requires us to know what they're thinking, which we cannot do yet, at least with as much confidence as we can read their basic emotion. So I want to end my talk with a few examples of research that has been done on higher level emotion. And the first example that I want to give you is to the research that has been done on guilt in dogs. So there's, if you look, you search on the web, there's like all these videos about, you know, dogs looking guilty, that, you know, people are posting their videos, clips of, on YouTube of their dogs. But do they really feel guilty? And there's even, about two weekends ago in the Spokesman Review, there was an article about the guilty look in dogs. And so there's, and this is, has been getting more and more popular since about 2009 when the first study showing about guilt in dog was published. And but what this study and a more recent one found is that we still don't know if dogs feel guilty. What they found in these studies that were like well-controlled, good design, they looked at, you know, if the dog was scolded, whether it had, it was guilty of eating the treat or not, well, they would show this guilty look. So the guilty look, based on this study, is more a response to the owner behavior. And a more recent study published in 2012, using a similar design, found similar results. They said they found that the guilty look is not a reliable indicator of if, whether the dog did it or not. It appears to be sensitive to the social condition, so the context and the relationship of the dog with the owner. But that doesn't mean that dogs do not feel guilty. It's just that at this point, even with well-done research, we don't know. The data that we have cannot doesn't allow us to say for sure that they are guilty or not. So more work needs to be done. My second example that I want to give you is about empathy. Empathy is defined as, you know, feelings of concern for other individual, experiencing emotion that match another's individual emotion, and also at knowing what another is thinking or feeling. So, and I like this example because it has been done on rats. Okay. So do rodents show empathy? So this is one of the best study or well-designed study that we have so far. And they actually did show, or their results suggest that yes, rats are showing empathy, but there are still questions that we cannot answer at this point. So what they did is they put one rat in a little container, and this rat was trapped in there. And there was another rat in the box that was free to roam around. And what they did is that the free rat was allowed to, or learn how to open the door. So you can see it here, the restrainer and the little door. So the free rat had to figure out how to open the door to let the other one out. And they compared that to an empty box and also to a box with an object. So what they found is that the rat was spending more time close to the center when there was a rat in there compared to the other two conditions. And they were also opening, they learned to open the door faster. And they were doing it over time, over the days of testing. They would do it more, even like quicker, if there was a rat in there rather than just nothing or an object. So they, it seems like, you know, they were showing empathy. So to make sure that, you know, how much they value like freeing another rat from being trapped, they also tested the rats. They compared an empty container versus chocolate chips, because we know that rats are very fond of sweet, they have a sweet tooth. So they compared an empty container versus chocolate chips or a trap rat versus chocolate chips. And even in this condition, they freed the trap rat first, and then they went to the chocolate chips. And what the authors are concluding is that what they are saying is that they shared, and it's true, so both rats got to eat chocolate chips. But were they really sharing the chocolates? So that we cannot say. I lost my thought. But so anyway, so there are still, you know, questions. So you can see that, I remember what I wanted to say. We don't know why the rat is opening the door. Is it because the other one, it's really feeling like, oh, you know, I wouldn't want to be in that box, and I want to open the door to let you free? Or is it just, you know, I don't want to hear you scream, and you know, I'm just opening the door? Or we don't really know what the rat is thinking. What is the motivation to open the door? But we know that they did it more often when there was a restrained rat. So, you know, we can see that there is some like form of empathy there, maybe not as much as a human, you know, with our thinking that we would see or we would do, but there is some form of empathy there. Okay, and finally, I want to end on another study that was done, published very recently, just this year. These researchers trained dog to remain still in a scanner machine, and they presented them with voices, and they were able to show that dogs have a region in the cortex that is similar to, or in a similar location as humans, for voice recognition. So, and this is kind of a first, because this is a limitation of this type of study, because how do you get an animal not moving in a scanner machine while you need, you know, to test them? So, I think this can lead to more knowledge, more information about what's going on in the cortex of animals. If we can train dogs, well, there's probably other species that we can train, and then we can test them. And that would add to the knowledge that we have right now about their basic emotion, and then help us understand what's going on at the higher level. And then there's also cognition, which has been, it's a company that has been started by Brian Hare, who's doing research on dog cognition. And what he's doing with cognition is to have people sign up to do some test with their dogs, and then send this information in a bank at the company, and so that all this information from all these owners around the world can be used to understand dog cognition, but not only dog cognition. So his long-term goal is also to understand the cognitive evolution of humans. So and that, you know, can also be used with other species, not just humans and dogs. So I think this is pointing towards some very interesting future for higher level emotion research in animals. So right now, currently, with the knowledge that we have about animal emotion and animal cognition, what we can do when we with animals that are used in research is minimize distress and suffering, facilitate their well-being, and also look at, you know, study positive emotions. Look at what's going on and how we can use those positive emotions in these situations. And that can also help us generate new ideas and develop new antidepressant drugs, for example. So to summarize, what we know about emotions and cognitions. So in the brain, we have we can divide the emotional system in three levels. The basic level, we can just call it feelings. We have learning and emotion and memory at the secondary level. And the tertiary level, the higher level, where we have socially complex emotion. All mammalian species share basic emotional systems in the subcortical areas of the brain. And so basic affects are the basis for higher level. If we don't have that level, we cannot build on this to get complex emotion at the higher level, complex emotions such as cognition. So an emotion is an integral component of an animal's state of well-being. So therefore, it can be used to assess the animal welfare, and we should use it. And I want to end on a quote by Jeremy Bentham, who was a philosopher and also a proponent of utilitarianism. So he said, the question is not whether they can talk or reason, but whether they can suffer. And basically what this means is that affects, so emotion, is the key. It's the important point. So that's all I have to say for now. Thank you.
So I was invited as a philosopher who's written on animal ethics to talk a little bit about why in our ethical thinking about animals, in our thinking about the ethics of how we treat animals, emotions on the one hand and cognition on the other hand should be taken into account. And what I want to do in this talk, primarily are the first two things. I want to compare what I characterize as a popular and political conception of the distinction between animal welfare and animal rights with the way that philosophers think about the distinction, because talking about this sets the stage for at least a really general framework for thinking about animal ethics and the place of feelings, emotions if you will, and various kinds of cognition in animal ethics. Now, time permitting, and I have started a timer here that will go off and tell me to stop in 15 minutes, but time permitting, I want to say a little bit about a particular perspective in ethics that I personally find especially helpful in thinking about animal ethics and about human ethics, but that's my particular project at this point in my career, so if I don't get there or can only talk very, very briefly about it, that'll be okay. So I've, over the years, given a number of presentations to veterinary students, to animal researchers, agriculturalists, etc. And in those kinds of audiences, if I just put these two words up on the board, I like to do this with no characterization under it, and I like to say something like the following. Imagine that you're watching a late night talk show, and the teaser before the commercial says that when we come back, Joe, an animal welfareist, will be here along with Bob, an animal rightist, an animal rights activist. And I ask them, what characteristics would you, right off the top of your head, sort of free association-wise, expect Bob and whoever the other name that I used was to have when they come back from the commercial? And inevitably, with very little prompting on my part, you get lists that look something like this, that, well, the animal welfareist is going to be the reasonable, moderate person who's revising and working within the system, is rational and calm and well-informed, and the animal rights person is going to be the opposite on each of these scores. And by the way, if people who know the names Peter Singer and Tom Regan, who are the two philosophers who have published the most and gotten the most discussion of their publications on animal ethics by researchers, people in College of Veterinary Medicine, will associate both of them with animal rights views. Now, I use the following, I like to use this cartoon because it sort of conveys the stereotype or the, since it's a cartoon, appropriately enough, a caricature of what an animal rights person would be. You missed the last part there. But again, in showing this cartoon, all I mean to emphasize is how this popular political conception is in the public mind and is kind of often in the background, unacknowledged and sometimes acknowledged, though, in discussions of animal ethics in our current political culture. What I want to spend my time focusing on, though, is how philosophers make the distinction between two underlying different ways of thinking about ethics in general, which can then be applied to our thinking about animals in particular, and yield what's on the one hand referred to, and Sylvie used the expression utilitarianism. Jeremy Bentham was a famous utilitarian from back in the 1800s. Peter Singer is one of the best known philosophers working squarely within a specifically utilitarian tradition in ethics. By contrast, Tom Regan endorses a very different kind of basic moral principle or basic moral theory that involves invoking individual rights, as is often said, as trump cards against utilitarian arguments. So if you ask, what do the two views hold? Utilitarianism is the view that right actions and institutions maximize the aggregate happiness or minimize the aggregate unhappiness of everybody affected by the action. People like Tom Regan claim that that's a wrong-headed way of thinking about our treatment of other human beings, at least. And someone like Tom Regan would want to be. The same goes for our treatment of many non-human animals. And I used this expression, trump cards, a moment ago. It's a nice kind of powerful metaphor for saying, in effect, you know, even if I have this lowly two of clubs, if clubs is the trump suit in the card game we're playing, doesn't matter how strong your hand of five cards in another suit is, I still win the hand. Well, similarly, the idea is that moral rights function as trump cards against people saying to you, we think we're justified in doing the following to you without your consent, against your will, because it's going to have so many more positive effects in the aggregate on others that they'll so much outweigh the negative impacts on you. To reason that way would be to reason like a utilitarian, doing in effect a sort of moral cost-benefit analysis. And the idea is that moral rights serve as barriers against, or trump cards, figuratively speaking. I guess barriers is also figurative, isn't it? Against such arguments. Now, if you look at the history of writing about moral rights on the one hand and utilitarianism on the other, you notice that Sylvie used a famous quote from Jeremy Bentham, saying it doesn't matter, can they reason? Are they things like self-aware? Do they have fancy episodic memories that they can work with, and conscious planning for the future? No, the core question, morally speaking, is can they suffer? Well, that is a widely shared commitment in the utilitarian tradition. But I do want to add the following. Utilitarians don't have to think that these more cognitive processes are irrelevant, because as Sylvie's presentation emphasized, at each level of those three tiers, there are emotions associated with the exercise of the increasingly complex cognitive capacities. And so, an individual's life can emotionally go feel better or worse for it in virtue of having various kinds of cognitive capacities. But it is true that in the utilitarian tradition, and especially in the wake of Peter Singer's famous book, sentience, by which he means the ability to consciously suffer and or enjoy in any which way, has been heavily emphasized, but also more specifically, the capacity to feel physical pain has been highly emphasized in the current work on animal ethics by utilitarians. And the idea there, though, that I want to emphasize at this point is not that these other capacities don't add emotional layers to your life and affect and can cause you to suffer and or enjoy in additional more complex ways, but rather that people tend to think that the ability to feel physical pain is sort of a practical cutoff, a signal of a cutoff layer beyond which life just can't feel better or worse for you at all. And the right reasoning there is that with the exception of human beings with congenital insensitivity to pain, which makes them incapable of feeling any physical pain, we don't know of any other beings on Earth that are capable of any other kind of more complicated emotion, if you were, or cognition-based emotion, that can't also feel physical pain. That doesn't mean that being able to feel physical pain is a necessary condition for being able to suffer and enjoy in these other ways. But the only exception to that, if it can't feel physical pain, then it can't suffer or enjoy in any way that we know of, are a few human beings with congenital insensitivity to pain. And by the way, their lives are really dicey. They have tended to die young because they do things like rub their eyes so badly that they'll lose their vision, chew on their tongues because it doesn't hurt and it just happens to, you know, be interesting, to the point where they severely damage their tongues, their lips, etc. And if you want to see, although this sounds kind of morbid that you would want to see this, but if you want to see this spelled out, there's a pain, there's an award-winning movie called A Life Without Pain that details the lives of three young children with congenital insensitivity to pain. On the other hand, though, in the rites tradition, insofar as it has been applied to human beings for centuries in the West, in the political West, there's been a tendency to tie possession of rites to more sophisticated cognitive capacities, and say that in order to qualify for rites, you have to have something like self-awareness and a sense of your future and being able to plan for it, make complicated decisions and trade-offs and so on. Now, what's going on with the contemporary animal rights movement is it is working within that intellectually respectable, solid philosophical roots tradition of talking about individual rights, but it's in effect arguing as follows. It accepts the trump cards against utilitarian arguments, conception of having moral rights, but then people like Tom Reagan and others, there's a complication there with regard to Reagan that I'm going to ignore, that we can come back to if you want. They endorse what you might call a sentience criterion for possessing rights. So they say, look, even if an organism can only suffer in relatively rudimentary ways like feeling physical pain, they still qualify for rights on such a view. Now, putting the view up here in this sort of skeletal way won't suffice to convince anybody of the view if they're not already convinced about it. But what I'm trying to convey in this presentation is, contrary to the cartoon caricature earlier of the animal rights activist, there's an obvious philosophical scaffolding here that can be fleshed out in a disciplined way by a thinker trying to adapt the individual rights tradition that has typically been at home with regard to human beings to an extension of it to cover, include some or many non-human animals. So what I've done so far is very quickly talk about the political popular conception and how a philosophical conception differs from that. And in the time remaining here, I'm just going to be totally quick and dirty, embarrassingly so, with what's in my book that I'll remind you of in a second. It's called, I refer to it as Herrian utilitarianism because I take out as my starting point in the book the two-level utilitarianism of R.M. Herr, and it turns out that there's the following connection to the current debate. Herr never in any extensive way wrote about animal ethics, but R.M. Herr's most famous graduate student at Oxford was Peter Singer. And Peter Singer increasingly in the course of his career has said that he endorses in its general strokes, Herr's two-level way of thinking about in utilitarian terms. So part of my project in the book was to say, I'm going to go back to Herr's theory, do a thorough exposition of it with regard to its implications for non-human animals, and see how much it matches up or fails to match up with the more abolitionist conclusions that Peter Singer is famous for advocating. Now, in the time remaining, all I can say is a total hand-waving to the effect of the two-level view says, even if you're convinced of utilitarianism as the ultimate moral truth, for day-to-day life and various kinds of circumstances, you need what he refers to as a system of intuitive-level rules. And those intuitive-level rules may include references to individual rights. So again, a very quick and dirty way of stating it is, if you want to maximize aggregate happiness for humans, the two-level view allows you to say, oh, but in our day-to-day interactions with each other, we might ought to train ourselves to think in terms of rights that are trump cards against thinking of each other merely as happiness receptacles or utility receptacles. And it turns out that from a utilitarian perspective, that intuitive level system should adapt across generations as background, technological, ecological, economic, various cultural, et cetera, conditions change. And I make a good bit of that in the book with regard to various kinds of animal ethics issues. I didn't say much in the book about research on animals specifically. That's being saved for the sequel. But the idea is, when it comes to animal research, my own view as a Harrian utilitarian is that there's no pat answer to what the right standards for governing experimentation on animals would be. That's going to be a contextualized question that's sensitive to various kinds of technological background conditions, et cetera. And without using right here a research-oriented example, let me use a sort of food-getting example. If you think about the ways that Plains Indians killed buffalo in pre-contact times, the famous buffalo jumps, we have records from the first written records from the first Europeans arriving, that those were really wildly inefficient ways of harvesting the resource, and also extremely inhumane ways of killing the animals. Run a bunch of buffalo off a jump, and the jumps aren't like the museum diorama shows of, you know, thousands of feet down. No, it's more of a very steep slope. Animals got injured, suffered very slow deaths. I have no problem with that, though, in pre-contact times, because they didn't have firearms, didn't have horses in pre-contact times, and yet bison were essential to the entire livelihood of Plains Indians in terms of the number of products that they got from them. So I personally have no problem with, as a two-level utilitarian, pre-contact Native Americans saying, well, yeah, we're going to kill animals this way. But I wouldn't think it would be appropriate today when we have much more selective techniques that could be used. I would say exactly parallel things, or I want to say exactly parallel things, about standards for research involving animals. And I just ran out of time. So thank you.
And mine is much more boring, I'm sorry to say. No, hopefully it won't be entirely boring, but it really takes an entirely different focus of what we're just talking about. We're talking about animal cognition, we're talking about, you know, the utilitarian versus animal rights, animal welfare, animal rights, and all that associated with it. I was asked to kind of provide the framework of what we currently use in the research setting today, and how you can start to see the different things that we were just talking about, how they will fit into that, and how they will actually affect into the future. But I need to do that, I need to provide you the framework. And let's see if I can get this to go. That framework, to be honest, I wasn't even going to do slides at first. I did decide to put a couple up here so you'd have something to look at other than me. I kind of like that a little bit better. But you need to realize that the use of animals in research and teaching is very highly regulated. That what we do and how we do it, there's a broad framework of laws, rules, and regulations that governs it. And so what you see here on the first one is probably, if you divide it in two main tracks, this would be one of them. This is the Animal Welfare Act. It's an act of Congress, originally passed back in the 60s, has been modified several times since then. It, interestingly enough, although it's labeled the Animal Welfare Act, it doesn't cover all animals. And so it is fairly specific in the animals that are covered underneath this act. So if you look in the first part of it, you open up to the section of definitions and you look at animals. The definition of an animal is as follows. So it's a warm-blooded vertebrate species. So things such as fish, amphibians, reptiles do not qualify underneath this act. But even with that in place, there's four exceptions written into the law. And those exceptions are rats of the genus Rattus, mice of the genus Mus, birds, and agricultural animals used in agricultural research. Why do I say this? I'll explain in a second. So what you see is we have this set of laws and rules that have been passed by Congress and are then given to the United States Department of Agriculture for enforcement. And that is done through, we have an inspector that will show up on our doorstep unannounced at least once each year. And they will go through and they will look at all of our animals that are covered by the Animal Welfare Act. And they will look at the animals themselves and they'll look at the conditions in which they're being housed. They will look at the protocols, the research is being done on those animals and checking compliance. So that's one arm. The second arm is really more public health service policy, and so this applies to anybody who receives federal money. And our university does receive quite a bit of federal money. In fact, if you look at the research projects that are being done, the goal usually for most researchers is to receive their R01 grants or to receive NIH money or grants from other sources in order to get the money to do the research itself. And when we're in that type of a situation, then we have two additional areas of rules and regs that come into play. And one is the guide for care and use of laboratory animals, and the second is the guide for the care and use of agricultural animals. Now, a couple of differences between this and the Animal Welfare Act. Again, animal is pretty much defined, but it's defined a little bit differently, because in the case of the guide, it is defined as all vertebrate animals. And so again, there's a cutoff point. It's got to have a spine. So the invertebrates, such as the insects and things like that, do not fall underneath any of these rules and regulations. But once you start getting in the point where there's a spine involved, all of them are covered. The rats, the mice, the birds, the amphibians, the reptiles, the fish, all that is included. And if you look, there's actually a lot of good overlap between the two. And what we see is one of the main components of providing this framework of how research is done, mandated in both the Animal Welfare Act and in the guide, is a committee for the institution called the Institutional Animal Care and Use Committee. And that committee becomes pivotal for any work that is done. And so what you see is a graphic, a representation of some of the responsibilities of that committee. Now, it's made up of at least 5 people. The people that have to be on the committee are, you have to have a veterinarian. That's my role on the committee here at WSU. You have to have a practicing scientist, somebody who is looking at it from that point of view. You have to have a non-affiliated member. That is somebody who is not part of your community, not part of WSU. So the rules that are placed on it is they cannot work for WSU. They cannot have a spouse that works for WSU. They can't have children that go to WSU. The entire concept behind that non-affiliated person is very important, is they become the unbiased person that can always vote their conscience with nothing being held over their head. Theoretically, I kind of like working here. And so if somebody said, either approve this protocol or you're fired, that could be held over my head. Now, I don't think it ever happened. There's too many other things in place there. But that, there is no such situation with the non-affiliated member. And so that's one of their roles on there. And then you have to have a non-scientist. And so all these people together, and then the committee usually grows depending on the complexity of the program that you have. And all these people together fulfill the different functions that you see listed up there. And one of the primary ones is what you see right up there at the very top. Approval of animal use. By law, all use of animals in research, teaching, and testing here at WSU have to be approved by this committee before they can happen. And that's a very key concept, that before process. Unapproved research is something that is, so if you didn't go through this process and you ended up doing something, that would be considered unapproved research, and that's something that gets a lot of strict attention. It ends up being reported to national agencies. There's all kinds of things that come along with that. So the purpose of this approval process is to go through and basically do an oversight of the research that's proposed to be done. And that's done on several different levels. As a veterinarian, one of my roles on the committee is to make sure that everything is appropriate from a veterinarian's point of view. So for example, if you're going to be doing surgery on the animals, I'm going to want to see the surgical procedures. I want to know, how are you anesthetizing the animals? What kind of drugs are you using? What dosages are you using them at? Because I've had instances in which those things were entirely inappropriate. We'll give you both ends of the spectrum. So when I asked for drug dosages, I had one when they sent me back the dosages because they hadn't initially included them. I looked at them and said, if you give that, the animal's dead. Because they had misfactored by 2 decimal points. And at the other times, I've had some where they were in a dose range. Usually things are given in ranges. And they were at the very low end of the range. But when you looked at the procedures they were doing, they were much more invasive. And so that low end of the range wasn't going to be adequate. And so in this case, the opposite was fact. You may give the drugs. The animal may be lying there on the table. But as soon as you start to do anything, it's probably going to try to get up and walk away from you. And so being able to have that veterinary perspective, that's one of the roles of the committee, is to make sure that everything is being done appropriately within that framework. But also within that framework is one of the other things that they look at. So I'm not going to come back to this, but you can see there's a lot of other things they do. But one of the other things that they really look at and consider are what are called the three R's. And this is a concept that was first introduced, I believe, is back in the 50s by two authors, Russell and Birch. 50
years ago.
Yeah. And so when we talk about the three R's, there's really three very specific things we're looking at. And the first one's replacement. So the question is, do we truly need to use an animal to ask this question or to answer this question? Or are there other methods that are available to us? Now, a lot of people will hold up computers, right? Computer modeling is a great thing. And you're right, you know, it's very true that there's a lot of stuff that we can model. But does it become the absolute end-all where you can replace the use of animals with it? No, because there's, in order for a computer to model it, there's really a lot of base information that has to go in. And sometimes, in fact, a lot of times, what we're dealing with is the unknown. And so with that unknown, it's hard to model. But at the same time, this has the potential to do a lot of good to move away from animals in general. Cell culture technique is another one. There's many questions that can be asked that instead of having to use the whole organism, you can simply do in a cell culture model. And so if that's the case, why use a live animal in the first place? The second one is refinement. So what can we do to make the procedures less painful? And really in a refinement, that's mainly what we're looking at, is the level of pain involved in the project that's being done. And probably the best refinement out there, using good drugs. As we increase the ability to provide analgesics and anesthetics to the animal, there's a lot that can be done to reduce pain. And so if we're looking at the amount of pain that's being felt, that's probably one of the areas where we can do an awful lot. Because, I think, okay, let me, vet school. So you heard in my introduction, I graduated in 96. I actually have a firsthand experience with this with an investigator and thinking back to it, where they were doing surgery in a dog. They did not want to provide post-operative analgesics to the animal, pain-relieving drugs. And the rationale behind it is because they wanted the animal to lie quiet in its kennel so that it wouldn't rip out the sutures. No. The rationale, and then I can see what they were aiming for, but their method of achieving it was inadequate because there's a lot of also unintended consequences. Pain itself is a major stress that will induce variable in the research itself. And so by doing so, what we've been able to find is that by providing proper pain relief, using things for adequate periods of time, that actually it's not just better for the animal, it's better for the research that occurs in it as well. It's a double win situation. And then the final R is reduction. And this becomes using the least number of animals possible. So if you have a question that you are asking, that you're striving to get an answer for, how do you determine how many animals to test that for in order to get your answer? And I know that it wasn't one of my favorite things when I was going through school, but that common word of statistics comes in here an awful lot. Doing the power analysis, doing the different aspects of the studies like that to determine the proper number of animals, depending upon the variables that you're asking and the variance within them, will make a big difference. Because the question, in a very base way of stating it, is if you say you're going to use four different experimental groups and you're going to use 10 animals per group, in essence, you're asking to use 40 animals. Where did the number 10 come from? How did you determine 10 animals per group? Because what happens if you could use 5 animals per group and still achieve statistical significance? Answer the question. In that case, you used 20 extra animals that you didn't need to. Or alternatively, what happens if you need 12 animals per group? In that case, you wasted all 40 animals because you never answered the question in the first place. And so as the IACUC goes through and reviews protocols, these are some of the things that they're looking at, trying to make the process as good as we can. But, and I want to end with a quote here to kind of show that, yes, we are on a bias here. So this is from the Guide for the Care and Use of Laboratory Animals, and this is the section entitled Ethics in Animal Use, and it states, the decision to use animals in research requires critical thought, judgment, and analysis. Using animals in research is a privilege granted by society to the research community with the expectation that such will provide either significant new knowledge or lead to improvement in human and or animal well-being. It is a trust that mandates responsible and humane care for the use of these animals. So that last part, to me, hit home significantly. Because if I'm going to take you and tell you a little bit about myself, and I won't because, well, I will. Time-wise, we're pushing it. But if you think about it, if you think of a veterinarian, who are you thinking of? You're thinking of the person that's treating your pet cat or dog in a small animal practice for the most part. If you came from a ranch background, you may be thinking of the person who comes out and helps with the cattle or horses. You're not thinking of somebody that works with rats, mice, and is in the research process usually. And so I get the question periodically when people find out that I'm the campus veterinarian for WSU. The first question is, what does that mean? And then when I describe it, the question is, why? Why would you do that? You love animals, right? Otherwise you wouldn't become a vet. And it goes back to many ways that animal welfare component of it. I believe in the work that's done. I see the good that comes of it. I've had a lot of firsthand experience and secondhand experience both ways of this part. Providing significant knowledge or lead to improvement in human or animal well-being. But at the same time, I think that I can have make a difference in that process to see that we fulfill that last sentence, that it is more humane and that it is our responsibility to do so. And so that's kind of the framework under which we're currently working, the laws that govern the use of animals currently today as we are. Now, will those change in the future? Potentially. Because as we talk through this dialogue that's going on nationally, and as we learn more about animals, what we understand about right and wrong and the ethics of it may change. But this is where we're currently at. And so I think at this point, I'm going to turn it back to Bill, and we'll go to a question and answer session.
Let's thank Dr. Russell. Can I invite you all to come up here now? So at this point, we want to open it up for questions that you may have. We've got at least 20 minutes. We may be able to sneak a few more in as well. And I believe that we have a couple of microphones. So Cornell Clayton has one over there. Is there another one over here, Cornell? Here you go. I can actually stand and take this one. Thanks very much. So if you have questions for any of our panelists, or maybe for all of them, this would be a good time to ask them. And if you would, wait till you've got the microphone to ask your question so that we get all this on tape. Incriminating evidence for later. No, I'm kidding. Who'd like to ask the first question? You want to know first name?
What's for the tape? Well, first, thank you. That was really very informative. I hope I have a lot of respect for the, you know, it's not whether they think or talk, but whether they suffer. And the sentience has been very prominent. That makes a lot of sense to me. But with all due respect, I think it does matter whether they think or talk. And I guess that's part of why we still privilege human well-being over animal well-being. I mean, please correct me if I'm wrong, both if that's true, I think that human well-being counts more than rat well-being. Maybe I'm that much of a dinosaur. And I think that what explains it actually comes down to something like our use of syntax, right? So, Philo wrote the first book, Philo of Alexandria, on vegetarianism, and he defends the rights of horses because they understand Greek. Is that not, so could you say something about, after all this, do humans still have any higher standing? And if so, what explains it?
You don't all have to speak to each question.
Right. Oh, I wish you would.
Well, I mean, not everybody. I don't want everyone to feel like that.
Professor Varner?
I'm going to say, we're going to turn to Gary here, okay. I think.
Well, you might notice that the title of my book was Personhood, Ethics, and Animal Cognition. And Peter Singer used, at one point in the book, I detail the different characterizations and sometimes definitions of person that he gives in the book. Now, person is a term of art in ethical philosophy. If it in day-to-day discourse, it sometimes just means a member of our species or a human being. But if that's what you mean by person, then the personhood of the fetus or the personhood of horses shouldn't be at issue, because one is and the other isn't a member of our species. When there are debates about personhood among human beings and with regard to non-human animals, what's meant is something like this. if we're going to call something, designate something a person in this context, it means that it has certain cognitive capacities, and in virtue of those cognitive capacities, deserves a special kind of respect that it wouldn't reserve if it lacked them. And the criterion for personhood that I defend in the book is having what I call a biographical sense of your life, a biographical sense of self. And the reason I think having that fairly sophisticated cognitive capacity, actually it's probably a suite of capacities, matters is that it allows your life to go better or worse for you, to enjoy and suffer in ways that you couldn't if you couldn't take that perspective, that storied perspective on your life. Without something like that storied perspective, it's just, you know, one damn thing after another, as they say about, you know, history that doesn't have a story to it or something like that. And similarly, with certain kinds of cognitive capacities that are up there at your third level, I think, like thinking about what's in the minds of others, for instance, and being able to think consciously about the non-immediate future, those kinds of cognitive capacities, I think, layer positive and negative experiences on a life that would lack those positive and negative experiences if you didn't have those cognitive capacities. So I tend to think in terms of a rough hierarchy of, I don't know if there are any conscious, any sentient animals that fall into the actually literally stuck in the immediate present category, but I would call that merely sentient. But then there are plenty, there's developing evidence in the scientific research on animal cognition to show that various non-human animals have the ability to consciously recall the past, consciously plan for the future, and so on. And I think those cognitive capacities layer value onto their lives. But in the book I review, I give my reasons for thinking that there's at present no good evidence of any non-human organism taking a biographical perspective on its life. And so I think that, you know, we've got like one more layer than, as far as we know at this point in time, any non-human animal does. And that would be my response, is to say I actually agree with what you said, but those were a sketch of my reasons.
I would actually, I mean, add on to that a little bit. You'll hear it commonly presented by animal rights activists, the term speciest, you know, relating it back to a racist or something else like that. One of the big differences, and I agree with Dr. Varnum, that there is a difference as far as we know. And that's one of the reasons that a speciest, to me, is not as negative, because it's based upon a true concept, whereas something like a racist or that was not based upon true concepts. And so, kind of coming back to that whole thing involved, I've heard it described, and I think it's probably a good way to do it. I don't see them at the table entering into the discussion about whether animals have that cognitive ability. And so I believe that there is a difference between the two. Just like you said, there's an extra function or an extra layer associated with there. And that's just talking from a philosophical aspect. Then there's all other, you asked about rationale behind it. You'd ask many people in the world today, and there's still a lot of different reasons they would come to the same conclusion. And I would guess probably theism would be one of them.
Yeah, and you know, if you look at the difference, the variation in the complexity of the cortex, which is where we have this tertiary level, it varies between species. And so I think the cognitive level of species will be different. We can acknowledge that, but what we know for sure is that every mammals at least, you know, share the same basic emotion. It's just at these higher level that there is difference, and you know, we need to acknowledge that. And we also need to be aware that maybe in the future research will show us that there is more similarities than differences, but there will definitely be, I think, differences, because we are different. At least, you know, if you look at the size of the cortex, it's different.
So. I can tell he wants to follow up.
One follow up, that's hard. So we can eat them because they don't talk as good as we do? Is that we have this extra layer, and that's what justifies our being able to eat them?
Well, we will never know what they're thinking. So
I sound a little complacent, but I mean, is that
Could I suggest a friendly reframing of the question?
Okay.
See if you agree with this. What exactly is it about biographical life that demands different treatment? Is that what you're asking?
A little too crappy for me, but yeah.
But he also wanted to ask about eating non-humans.
Right.
Let me see if I can say two things quickly. Exactly what is it about having a biographical consciousness that, I forget how you put it, but if you said makes your...
Differential treatment.
Oh, demands differential treatment. Thank you. I'm very careful in the book, I may not have been a second ago here, to say that I don't think that having these layers of cognition that add, that enrich your life, can enrich your life in various ways, necessarily makes your life better. Those cognitive capacities, like planning for the future, can make your life go a hell of a lot worse because you can be worrying to death about bad things that are coming in the future. So each of those cognitive capacities, I think, is a knife, a double-edged sword that cuts both ways. And so the way I put it is not that it makes your life somehow intrinsically better than another organism's, but rather it means that we can harm you and benefit you in our interactions with you in ways that we couldn't harm or benefit an animal that lacked those cognitive capacities. And admittedly, this is a metaphorical and figurative way of putting it, but the take-home point from that, I think, is that we need to be more cautious in our dealings with you, take sort of extra precautions in various ways. What the specifics of those extra precautions or extra standards would be is a long story that I don't have the answer to, but that's the basic rationale for it.
I'm a veterinary student, and I often get told, why aren't you a vegetarian? And I usually respond, well, neither are the animals. So that is one theory of, you know, for me, it's not whether or not I am eating an animal, it's whether or not I can reduce harm and I can reduce suffering. So that is one of the reasons that I go into veterinary medicine, is because I would like to ultimately reduce suffering. And so whether or not I can control that in the environment of the animal that is going to eventually become food is what I focus on, not necessarily whether or not I'm eating an animal versus an animal eating another animal.
What's interesting there is the fact that there are very few species on this planet that can survive without doing that survival based upon other life. Now, unless you've got chlorophyll under your skin and can get your energy from the sun, you're going to be deriving your energy chain from another form of life. Whether that life is a plant or an animal, it's still a life. What you're doing is you're drawing a line somewhere in the sand that's saying, okay, a plant is a lot different than me, so I don't care about it, but it's still alive. Some people are drawing that line higher up and saying, okay, an animal is a lot different than me, and so they're drawing the line in a different place.
Other questions?
John Kramer, veterinarian for 50 years, both commercial, industrial, and teaching. What would you accept as evidence that this is not permissible, that we should treat all levels of animals equally, is what I presume you're saying here. Now, as individuals who've had a few PhD students, there's something that's missed when you ask a question. You must be able to present the answer which you would agree with, as well as the difference that would counteract your approach.
Now I have to back the microphone. Oh, no. Okay. Let's see.
You can hold it for a
second. Here's one thing I feel really ignorant of that I wish I knew. How much is animal testing directly responsible for improvement in human well-being, and necessarily so? If I knew better, like he talked about these three R's, if I knew more about, if you couldn't replace the animals at all, if we absolutely need them, then I feel better in a way. But if we can replace them, I feel like we're complicit in a whole lot of needless pain. And it sounds to me a lot like the arguments that were used to defend slavery, too, actually. Did that answer your question, or begin to answer your question?
No.
No.
I'll tell you why.
Okay, tell me why.
The question you said, if you had some indication
Well, you asked me what I needed to know to come to a conclusion.
All right, I'll give you one. You're looking at the one of the inspectors of the first three batches of the salt vaccine for polio. Quality assurance. We have not completely eliminated polio from the world as a result of those, but we've come a long way to where we see children in every high school class or of that age dying, three in my classes back then, or walking away with, what shall I say, lesions that are going to hinder them for the rest of their life. You can look at this also in the HIV vaccines. The work had to be done in animals first before we went on. These are the examples that are outstanding out there for us. And this goes on to smallpox, it goes on to a few others. And in the monkey world, we were destroying 100 macaques a week to prove the vaccine was significant in the batches for probably 5 years before the cells that we call now that live forever were replaced the old monkey. That's in vaccine. And now if you want to talk about drugs and foods,
Research is not just about human, it's also about animals. Take, for example, the Tasmanian devils populations are declining because they are affected by this rare type of cancer that is affecting the population. And so research has to be done to figure out what we can do for them.
I have a kind of a spin-off from the discussion here. I said at one point in the presentation that, well, it seems like the classic defense of animal research always is that the benefits outweigh the costs. But for any, you know, that you find the vaccine and then look at all the human suffering you save into eternity, yes, you cause some suffering in order to get the cure, but it outweighs in the long haul. But I do think that's how researchers tend to think about the justification of their research. And people doing actual science that they're sending over protocols to the IACUC here are, it seems to me, always making judgment calls about what the lines of research that are more and less likely to pay off are. And this leads me to a question I actually wanted to ask Steve, which is the following, just a really short setup. When I've talked to friends of mine from various places who have served on IACUCs, they've reported that at some universities, the IACUC feels that it should ask that question, is this really worth doing? How reasonable is it to think that the likelihood of a payoff is big enough to justify the use of the animals? And my question for you is, that seems like making a sort of moral judgment call about the justifiability of the research. Mm-hmm. And as I understand it, some IACUC, some places actually do that. Others, that's completely forbidden. That they don't even reach that question.
Well, yes and no. It can be addressed in a couple of different ways. So you're right, it's a very thorny question, because how do you tell somebody else whether their research is valid or not, and whether it has the potential to achieve something of lasting of impact? Because oftentimes the problem is research and the advancement of knowledge is usually not made in huge steps. It's the small steps that get you out there. And so that small step may not seem very significant, but it may lead to yet another one that goes somewhere. And so whether the IACUC addresses that directly or indirectly, once again, is going to be to some extent based upon the committee itself, but there is always indirect ways that is assessed, one of which is through the whole process of where the money comes from to pay for this. Most of the research that occurs is funded by outside agencies. And if you look at the funding rates as they occur, so if you're applying for an NIH grant, your funding rate right now is about 6%. And so you know that you have a body that has looked very strongly at the science involved in the work that's going to be done and the potential for, A, for it to work, and B, for the effect thereon. And in order to receive the money to do it, you know that you're in the top 6%. I mean, 94% of they've said sorry. And so that's one method that it's assessed as well. And we got all kinds of hands starting to go up now. Woo!
Hi. Actually, I have a question that I think is kind of following up on that. So it's a little worrisome. And by the way, I'm a huge fan of research. Uh-huh. I'm not suggesting otherwise. But it seems a lot is being put onto, say, the NIH funding agency to actually be doing this indirect method to see that they're vetting things. And I don't know. I've written one or two grants, and I have no idea, frankly, how they're actually decided at times. And it might just be, and I noticed up here in the ethics and animal use, it has a disjunction. The disjunction is it must provide either significant new knowledge or lead to improvement in human and or animal well-being. I kind of want to know, do the funding agencies, do you feel confident, if you will, that the new knowledge actually does lead to a benefit? Now, I'm a philosopher. I think knowledge has a lot of value, okay? But it seems what's really important in this case, like when we're talking about polio vaccines, etc., is we're talking about benefit. So I'm wondering how far the discussions actually do go toward our reasonable expectation of benefit.
At the NIH, you mean?
Yeah, at the NIH or at IACUC, either right. One. And what's your confidence in that?
Well, I can tell you, though, there is one question that's mandated by the Animal Welfare Act and in the forums that deals specifically with that question. You know, what's the potential impact is the gist of the question. And so it is something that is thought about and discussed. And also looking at the work that's being done, that's one of the things that's hard to do. One of the things I like about my job is I kind of get my fingers, because I review all those different protocols, I kind of feel like I get my fingers in everything that's going on across the university to some extent. And I can tell you that by far the vast majority really is applied science that's going on, where it is trying to answer a very specific question. There is some basic research, and I don't want to denigrate the basic research because I think it has a strong component or a strong reason for it to occur. But I can tell you that almost the vast majority of the research that's going on here at WSU is more of an applied ring where they're asking a very specific question that deals almost directly, especially with having the vet school, with animal health for the most part, but also human health as well. And so I feel pretty confident in it.
So one of my questions is, what can we do to better bridge the gap between public perception and current research models being done with animals?
Communication.
Maybe more specific.
Transparency, so that you know people know about what's going on, and that's one criticism of scientists and researchers is that they are not telling people what they're doing really, so that. You know, it's like always like all the doors are locked and you don't really know what's happening behind the doors. And so I think scientists need to tell people what they're doing exactly so that people understand what is done to the animals and how they care for the animals. A lot of people don't know that there's a committee at the university that is overlooking the research that is done. So this is one important point. And if you don't know about that, you know, how can you have a good understanding that scientists are taking care of their animals or care of about the life of their animals?
I'll just add a little bit on that one, too, because I agree entirely. The communication is the problem, and as I see it, really, you've got multiple groups of people in the world, and I'm going to simplify and say, I'm going to say animal rights activists on this side, the groups that really go for the abolition entirely, and there's some of those. Those groups, if you think about the ones that you most commonly think of when you say the word animal rights activists, they're pretty vocal, aren't they? They are very good. That's one of their things, is they're very good about getting their message out to the public, and that's one of the things that they strive for. And as Sylvie said, on the other side, I don't think the people who are doing the research are, for the most part. They have a tendency to be very good in what they do, but they're very quiet and they're very insular, and they want to pull back if there's ever any hint of controversy, a lot of it. And so what we hear is, on the one side, we hear the one side, but we don't hear the other. And so if you look at the meter of public opinion, if all you're hearing is one side, that meter starts to swing further and further that direction. And so there has been a a number of groups that have really started trying to do this, to try to get the public aware of what the rules are, making sure that they understand that there are rules governing the use of the animals. It's not just willy-nilly do whatever you want, but also the benefit and everything else that get people to thinking about it a little bit. And that's the main thing that I found is when people think about it, I think that usually they don't end up on one of the two extremes. They end up in the middle somewhere thinking about, okay, the benefit is there, but we also do need to be aware of the animals and what we're doing with them. And so having that is very important. But if they just hear the one, it's not a good thing.
This reminds me of a conversation that's been going on for several decades in the production agriculture community, where there's the same theme sounded that the rights activists are getting their message out very effectively, and we're not on the agriculture side. And it does occur to me that one thing that some farms have started doing is having, you know, the public comes in on a weekend or something. Now, you can't do that in a lab, given the conditions that you have, but you might be able to brainstorm things that don't involve a class of high school students traipsing through a lab that needs to be kept secure, but have, I don't know, functions on campus or in the community that somehow get a more nuanced and detailed message out.
And actually, we do have some of that, and I agree there's a lot more that can be done. I mean, for example, how many of you have done a presentation at your elementary school on the work that's being done, not to the kids? I mean, just getting out and talking about things. I see one in the back. Thank you, Charlie. I know that you have. And being willing to talk about what you do and set that type of things up. Cougar camp, or the cougar quest that we occur here over the summer, I know that we've had those in the past set up for people and kids to experience the animal research side of it and understand what goes on it, because really it is more of an understanding. And to recognize that there is a purpose behind it and that it is done under constraints of looking out for the welfare of the animals.
Our time is up. So on behalf of the Foley Institute and on behalf of the School of PPPA, I want to thank you all for coming out this evening. And join me now in thanking our panelists for a really interesting conversation.